hello. We met up with Samuel, the founder of Delics. Delics is an organization that is aiming to connect people who are interested in psychedelic therapy with experienced facilitators and practitioners in the field, building a platform to promote the healing potential of psychedelics. We are quite happy to share this interesting conversation about the future of the integration of psychedelic medicines in our mainstream society, and if the world is actually ready to receive those treatments. Yes, enjoy.
So Samuel, first, I think I'm going to record a little intro, but anyway, in your own words, could you tell me a little bit about the past years, what led up to you starting what you are doing right now, and who you are, where you come from?
Yeah, sure, absolutely. So I think it was actually December 2019 that I decided to quit my job at FunBov. I was working for an electric bicycle company, and I still had a couple of months on my contract that I needed to finish. So I actually finished in February 2020. And February 2020 goes into the books as, you know, the month that Corona came to Europe. Although we're not entirely sure, but that's when I quit my job, rented out my apartment, and left for India with the idea of, okay, I'm going to start my own business. And so the idea was go to India, do a meditation retreat there, come back, book a ticket to Berlin, and, you know, start a startup life in Berlin. And as I was in India, and as I was at that meditation retreat, where you're completely cut off from, you know, the outside world, I came out and I realized that in Italy, shit was going haywire, right? And I decided to take like an early flight back, which turned out to be like one of the last commercial flights at that point back from India. And I know a couple of people that actually got stuck there. And after that, India went crazy. So now I'm back in the Netherlands without a job, living with my mom. I rented an apartment in Berlin and I was in lockdown. So I was like, okay, what am I going to do? And so the first 2-3 weeks I decided, okay, I'm going to stay here, stay put, see how this all pans out. Still kind of thinking that this would be like a couple of weeks, maybe a couple of months kind of thing. And once I realized that this was like a long-term thing that we had to live with, I decided, fuck lockdown. I'm just going to pack my bags and I'm going to go to Berlin. And so I went to Berlin. Berlin was in lockdown. I came in at Hauptbahnhof there, and it was so quiet. It was as if I was like arriving in like a ghost village. And everyone there was super strict. So in my neighborhood, people only went to the supermarket. So I come to this apartment. And I'm in this apartment with my late co-founder, and we're like, okay, let's start a business. But we didn't know what to do. Wow. We couldn't get out of the apartment, and we were in a city where we knew no one. So that's kind of where the journey started of me trying to figure out what I wanted to do. And we ended up starting a nootropics company, where we took nootropics and wanted to bring it to like the masses. So there's a, you know, tiny group of like very enthusiastic, mostly techie people that take nootropics, like supplements for the brain. And we thought there could be a bigger market out there. And so we incorporated these nootropics into a food product and then wanted to market that. Multitude of reasons why it didn't work, like high minimum order quantities, low demand because we still needed to educate, and high upfront investment. And so after a couple of months, we quit. But in the meantime, in Berlin, through a friend, I met someone at Mind Foundation. And she inspired me to think more about, because I was always into psychedelics and always like recreationally, spiritually into psychedelics myself. It helped me a lot in the way I, you know, look at the world, think about the world and myself. And I met her, Sasha, and she told me about Mind Foundation and the work they're doing there, and the therapeutic application of psychedelics. And that's where kind of the ball started rolling. I'm now thinking, because actually that's probably not even exactly how it went, because before I met Sasha, mm-hmm. I remember that I ordered a microdose from the Netherlands and got it shipped to Berlin.
That worked smoothly.
It worked, yeah. Actually. Yeah, it worked. And that was really interesting because at that point I was like, wait a second. Maybe if it's actually possible to ship it to Berlin in like regular Dutch mail. And I then immediately messaged the company where that was Earth Resonance that I got it from. And I messaged them and I was like, is that legal? And they sent me some sort of European decree that actually it's legal. Mm-hmm. And I was like, yeah, maybe I should start doing this in Germany and bring microdosing to Germany. Turned out more difficult than I thought it would be. And then I met Sasha and she kind of like introduced me to like the therapeutic application of psychedelics. So that's how I rolled into like the world of psychedelics a little bit. And then at first I thought, and this is where the idea for Delics was generated. I thought like, okay, why don't I start retreats with different themes? I think by now everyone in the psychedelics industry has at one point thought about organizing a retreat, right? So I was like, okay, retreats for people with depression, retreats for people with anxiety disorder, or people that wanna like bring out their inner creativity, etc. And so I started looking for practitioners or, you know, guides, if you will, to aid me because I don't have like a mental health care education to help me and set that up so that they could actually facilitate, etc., etc. And then I started looking and it turned out that for me, it was actually really difficult to find a guide that I felt I could trust. And that's from like a business sense, because you've got like shamans, you have guides, you have trip sitters, you have space holders, you have psychedelic psychotherapists, etc., etc., etc. And in all different ranges, some working for businesses like Field Trip or Synthesis, others working alone. So where do you go, you know? And that's kind of where the idea sprouted, like, okay, it's interesting. There's a lot of money being poured into this industry. There's a lot of innovation going on the pharma side of things. There's companies now focusing on providing therapy, but there's no real infrastructure. And so I thought, why not build the infrastructure? And that's how Delics came to be.
Nice.
Beautiful.
It's a beautiful story. Yeah.
Beautiful story. Yeah.
It's quite a new venture as well. Right? You're one of the really riding the early psychedelics wave, I guess. Yeah. You're not. If you didn't really feel like there's a new wave of entrepreneurs coming into this industry. Yeah. So what was that turning point for you? When were you like, okay, I'm going to dive into psychedelics? Was it this microdose or did you have some kind of experience yourself or what was that?
I mean, I wish I could say it was a breakthrough experience and I was like,
and now it was like this or was not like this?
No, it was not. Okay. No, it wasn't. Would have been cool for the story, but it wasn't. No, it kind of like, I think it just happened gradually. And my first psychedelic experience myself, I was 16 and this is, I think, so I don't know, this is in 2007 and I did like, cubensis, I think I did it. So mushroom cubensis.
The truffle form or like actual mushrooms?
No, because at the time mushrooms were still legal. So we did mushrooms and it was an incredible experience. And so, you know, I read into it and I, you know, got a lot of people around me to go into it. And yeah, it was always kind of like a part of my life in some way. And then somehow things just started like speeding up and I'm not entirely sure if it was really a decision of mine to go into it or it just happened because of my natural interests and mm-hmm. yeah.
Yeah, that's why I'm asking. So, you know, you have people who have like, oh man, I saw God and now I want to dive into this scene. But for you, it seems like it's not that case. So for you, it's more like a logical decision. So then, you know, during this day and age, for me, it's interesting to see what drives people to move into the space.
Yeah. Right.
Is it that they see, you know, a business opportunity? Do they see a problem? And it's to me, it seems like you found a problem. So the infrastructure was lacking and you saw a market opportunity. You knew that it would help a lot of people. Is that correct?
Yes and no. So I think It sprouted mostly from my innate interest and passion for what psychedelics could do to me personally, and then being confronted with that market opportunity, I was like, okay, wait a second, like, I love reading about this, I love doing it, I can actually help people with this, so why not? And so, yeah, I did see the market opportunity, although it's still a very risky market opportunity. But and I thought, let's just do it. I've worked for, you know, as a marketeer, not really with a clear purpose that connected, you know, my work to the rest of my life. I worked as a consultant in you know, the same way. It didn't really connect with me. And when getting engaged with psychedelics, I was like, okay, this is something I really connect with, so why not make my work out of it as well?
And now you talk about psychedelics, but can you maybe narrow this down? Like, what kind of psychedelics do you think the world is ready for now? Like, should everyone just take a certain psychedelic, or who should take a psychedelic, who should not take a psychedelic, and which psychedelics are like the first frontline of healers? Like,
right. Wow. Okay. I think that's a difficult question. I think there's a lot of people self-medicating right now. There's a lot of people taking psychedelics recreationally for spiritual purposes. What I personally find really, really interesting is how the mental healthcare space and spirituality are actually starting to melt together. And we see that proper mental healthcare has to do with the way that you are positioning yourself in life. So it's actually connected to a spiritual practice, maybe. Mm-hmm. But what exact substances would be good for different kind of people is, it's really difficult for me to say.
But, you're like focusing on
psychedelics, I mean.
Yeah.
Like.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So with psychedelics, we focus on policy. So we follow policy. So let's say in the Netherlands, it's possible now to take truffles, and it's possible to say, hey, I'm a facilitator and I give you truffles, and then we get to work. It may not be insured, but it is possible. So in the Netherlands, we want to facilitate the connection between what we call guide seekers and the practitioners when it comes to therapy involving truffles. When it comes to, for example, ayahuasca or DMT or any other type of substances, we don't want to do that in the Netherlands. Why? Because A, it wouldn't be legal. And B, we also want to set an example that it is possible to do this legally and grow with policy.
And so you're focusing mostly on psilocybin, but we know that, you know, in the Netherlands, I have a question from a friend of mine. I'm going to address it right now because I'm going to get it out of the way. We have a friend of mine who's a psychotherapist, I believe. And of course, this industry has a lot of challenges, right? Mm-hmm. We are not engaged in an industry where you can just get a product somewhere and just sell it or offer a service fully. There is some difficulties in doing this. And she said, like, okay, every country has its own national registration system with healthcare professionals like the BIG, and therapists are not officially allowed to give this sort of work, right? So every country must probably be way different in that sense. But they're not, most therapists are not allowed to discuss diagnosis. So psilocybin assisted therapies are only still happening within the context of clinical studies. So how do you deal with such a messy slash difficult environment with people who are seeking help and therapists wanting to give this help, and how, where does your startup come in?
Yeah, so it is really messy at the moment, and I'm kind of banking on it getting less messy and easier to digest. But at the moment, I'm not looking to solve all the problems in the industry, rather build an infrastructure for what is possible at the moment. So what we do with Delix, we want to connect practitioners to guide seekers, if these practitioners are BIG registered and not allowed to actually do this, that might mean that they want either a certain type of anonymity, or if these practitioners are not BIG in the Netherlands, then BIG registered, and they are actually providing this kind of therapy, then they can, but it won't be insured, right? Mm-hmm. So we want to allow for these people to connect to each other and involve the practitioners in the building of the product, which we are not finished yet with, so that we can actually tackle these problems one at a time. And there's many legal problems with what we're trying to do, and we want to stay within legality as much as possible, but we also want to push the boundaries of what is possible, and not let backwards policy direct what we do when we see that there's actual proof that this is working and this is helping people. Is that an answer to your question?
Yeah, it is. And our so what type of people are wanting or to make use of Delics, of your software?
Yeah, so this is really interesting, because when you know, the idea inception happened, naturally we thought, okay, there's many like psychedelic enthusiasts that would be interested in this, and then we figured out that actually no, it's not psychedelic enthusiasts that are interested in it, because they usually have found their way and they may do this with trip sitter friends or just do it on their own. But there's a very big group of people. Take, for example, people with depression worldwide. There's now like approximately 264 million people with depression. So about 30% of those people are either treatment resistant or treatment refractory. And that's a lot of people that can potentially be helped with psychedelics. For example, also if we look at the research that has just been done at Imperial College. But most of these people look at psychedelics as being some sort of hippie shit that they don't want to touch, when actually it could like improve their lives. So what we want to do is be there for the people that don't necessarily know that much about psychedelics, but they still are looking for a solution to their mental illness.
So it is definitely focused on people with mental illness. You're not trying to get into the field of human optimization and like getting people on board that are officially not depressed or have any sort of mental illness, but who want to improve their life or just want to become happier people or want to take psychedelics in order to, yeah, explore, achieve spiritual growth, explore personal development. Is this a field you want to tap into as well, or are you merely focusing on the healing the officially depressed?
Right. Yeah, so when we started with this, the idea was to do both. And the idea was not only to have a platform, but also to have to publish a lot of content, maybe to sell products that have to do with psychedelics, etc., etc., etc. Help people with you know, optimization of their life, help people that are coping with mental illness, etc., etc. But like, as we kind of conceptualize further along, we notice that okay, we want to do everything and we cannot do everything. And so we started to cut away the things that we didn't want to do. And at the moment, we want to focus on people with mental illness. If it turns out, according to, you know, policy, that it would be more difficult to actually go through with this and focus on, you know, optimization of not sick people first, then we can still pivot and we can still do that. But I think, you know, most societal benefit can be achieved when focusing on the mentally ill. So we want to try and tackle that first. And if it turns out that it doesn't work yet, because we might be too early, then yeah, this is also a communications decision, right? Yeah.
Yeah. There's a lot of challenges here, I guess, but the research is definitely in your favor. You mentioned a little research done by the Imperial College of London, right? So could you tell us what's inside that research?
So what they did there is actually compare a specific SSRI, which is an antidepressant, one of the most regular used ones, which of course I forgot the name. Do you know the name by any chance? No, I forgot the name at the moment. I can look it up for you. With psilocybin, and they tested whether the antidepressants worked better on people with depression or the psilocybin actually worked better on people with depression. And you saw that psilocybin on almost all criteria scored better on treating depression than the antidepressants did. So psychedelics do not only provide better results in the long term, according to this initial research, but they also provide immediate results and immediate feedback. So after a trip or even during a trip, someone experiences immediate results, whereas if you start an antidepressant, it could take weeks, if not months, for you to start feeling results. So as it works with science, you know, after publishing research, it was said like a lot of extra research has to be done, and it will have to be done, and we will probably be trying to prove all these things for many decades to come. But it's showing me that there's a lot of promise there. Yeah.
What do you think are the biggest pitfalls, like, or what could happen? Like, what could, like, really ruin your mission? Or, like, where are the biggest challenges in, making your vision a reality?
Yeah, so I think it's policy reform. So what I'm really banking on is when I look at current trends in policy reform is that they are not only going to keep going, but, like, the speed with which they are being implemented. With reforms being implemented, is also going to increase. And so if that doesn't happen, I don't think there's a good case for us. Mm-hmm. So that is, I think, one of the biggest challenges. Next to that, there is the so-called scientific challenge. So I read somewhere the other week that, so it has been proven now that you can treat end-of-life anxiety for people with cancer if you give them psychedelics. But according to science, if they are suffering another disease and they have end-of-life anxiety, you cannot give them psychedelics because it's not being proven that this actually works, right? So now does our common sense tell us that, okay, we shouldn't do that?
Yeah, but you should never listen to your common sense.
Right. But you see what I mean? Yeah. So first of all, okay, so it's only for cancer patients.
Yeah.
So are we talking about end-of-life anxiety or are we talking about cancer patients? So how can we transfer the little evidence that there is in very specific cases to other cases? And can we make a case for that? I think that is like a big, big challenge. Science has its place and is extremely important in order to prove all these things. But I think sometimes we hold on too dearly to what a specific type of research has said. Whereas maybe if the hypothesis would have been formulated slightly differently, then we could have had proof that it works for all types of life, for end of life anxiety. So if you take that analogy a little bit further, it's okay. So it helps for end of life anxiety for cancer patients, but does it also help for people with other type of disease? And if it helps for end of life anxiety, doesn't it just help for all anxiety? But because isn't the worst anxiety end of
life? What is anxiety? What is depression? Anxiety? Like, how are these terms defined in the first place?
Exactly. So how can we see harmonically and neurologically what these things are? And can we then basically jump ahead of science and say, okay, we're just going to, use this for people with these type of problems because obviously it works. We just need to wait until science has proven it.
Do you feel there are some example countries where like psychedelics are like more integrated into into medicine or
Canada?
Canada, yeah. Do you feel this is like the leading?
Why Canada?
Well, because it was one of the first country or the first countries to allow commercial initiatives into therapeutic use of psychedelics. So they have been at the forefront. I think politically they also have a liberal climate, which would allow for more innovation within the scene. You could also say the United States is definitely not the Netherlands, that's for sure. If anything, we are going a little bit backwards when it comes to policy here. But it's more like a hunch. I would say Canada. What would you say?
Well, we've seen some weird stuff coming from Canada, right?
Yeah.
web shops selling LSD suddenly, or DMT just out in the open, and
right.
Yeah, it indicates what's the progression there, and in the Netherlands, it seems like and the Netherlands has a very tight healthcare system. Of course, mm-hmm. everything is super regulated mm-hmm. and overseen. So I don't think everything is highly evidence based. Mm-hmm. So this will be a tough country to work in for you. So if people have the same problems that what they would come for to Delics for, mm-hmm. where do they go now, other than Delics?
Yeah, so this is kind of the problem, right? Because there are directories out there. So there are a couple of initiatives that or companies that are actually focusing on listing practitioners. The problem at the moment is that it's very transactional. So it's like, okay, so you're coping with issues, mental health issues. We have a list of 400 practitioners here. Check your location, and then we have someone that can help you. If I could make a comparison to more well-known companies, that would be the Craigslist of psychedelics. We want to be more a company that allows people that seek guidance to trust the practitioner that they choose for. So instead of giving them a listing of of a directory of 400 practitioners, we say, actually, we have curated a couple of practitioners in your area that are really, really good. And so we try not to tell them, here's a couple of practitioners and choose, but we try to tell them, listen, here are a very limited amount of practitioners. This is their experience level. These are the reviews that they got from other people, ratings that they have had, diplomas, et cetera, et cetera. And so maybe even a little video introducing them on the platform, so that people that normally would be hesitant to do this because they're scared can start to trust engaging in psychedelic psychotherapy.
Yeah. And on the other side, you have the facilitators. How do you call the people assisting with psychedelics? You had a word for it, right?
Yeah, so we call them practitioners.
Practitioners. And who are these practitioners who apply for your platform?
So we have different kinds of practitioners that have applied. So there's practitioners with a more formal background, posing very similar questions as the one that your friend posed. Okay, but wait, what if I'm BIG registered? I am not actually allowed to do this outside of clinical trials. And then see, because... So let's step back for a second. Let's be very clear about this. They do this. They do actually give this kind of therapy. Like, there are many BIG registered therapists who are doing this. They're just not allowed to, right? So this is really interesting. So the experts in the field are actually figuring out that they can help the people that come to them for advice and that come to them for help using psychedelics, but they don't want to do it out in the open because it's not exactly legal. So there's a couple of those, but there's also people that are more of a shamanic nature, or people that are space holders or trip sitters that have more the philosophy of, I want to facilitate someone in their trip without interfering at all. and just making sure that if they need to go to the toilet, they can hold their hand, etc., etc. And so there's many different people with different philosophies. And what I do not want to do with Delics is discriminate between them. But what I do want to do, and we are now working on a way to actually vet them, not according to one criterion, which would be, for example, a psychology major, or just another criterion, which means that person has helped 200 people, but combining a couple of criteria so that depending on which corner of the psychedelics world you come from, there are still ways that you are able to help people.
Right. So to recap, if I want more a spiritual healer, you might go for a curate, somebody who's, you know, like you say, a little bit more on that side. Or if I want really, like, you know, a very medical person, then you also have facilitators in that area.
Yeah, so let me be clear. We are not live yet, so we don't have any facilitators on the platform right now. We are building it. But the idea is that people can choose according to their needs which practitioner would fit them best. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you feel there's a certain problem that comes with advertising your company if you have like such different practitioners like working with you? That there's some people who's like, oh, like I don't know if this is the right thing or if this is the right thing, or like. Because you said you want to attract everyone with like a certain kind of like mental problem, but do you feel some people might be kind of like turned off if there's also like some more shamanistic like healers?
Yeah, so
and the other way around.
Yeah, so let me give you, for example, a comparison from Airbnb. If I have a closet in my home which stinks, and if I cut my one person mattress in half, it fits in the cupboard, and I put a little blanket in there, does that make Airbnb a bad platform? No, not necessarily. Why not? Because they work with a review and rating system, so it weeds out actually the practitioners that wouldn't be doing a good job, or the practitioners that people are apparently not looking for, because they get less reviews, they get less ratings or less good ratings. And so the idea is by setting up such a review system that the platform becomes a lot more relevant.
That's very exciting.
Yeah. Yeah, right?
That's very exciting.
So we are not necessarily choosing a direction, but we are gonna see where the market wants to go and facilitate that direction.
And what would be the ideal future and infrastructure for psychedelic assisted psychotherapy, and how do we get to that point?
Can you rephrase that?
So right now the situation in the Netherlands is far from optimal, but worldwide we are facing, you know, not an ideal situation for people who want to get help with psychedelics. So what would be the ideal situation? Would there be hundreds of Delics platforms, or do you have any vision of how people could ideally be helped with psychotherapy, or is Delics that answer?
I think Delics could be that answer. I think when there's too many platforms out there, that kind of defeats the purpose of trying to provide clarity to people, right? So even though there should be healthy competition so that like the best platform comes out as a so-called, you know, winner in the industry, I think it would be highly beneficial if there's one go-to platform that people go to if they want to be helped in their psychedelic journey. And I believe that that could be Delics. Having said that, we are not planning to necessarily only launch in the Netherlands or even launch in the Netherlands at all. I am in the Netherlands and I am setting this business up from the Netherlands, but we may well launch in California first, or in Oregon first, or in Canada first.
Right.
Yeah.
And there are in Oregon, I also heard that there will be physical locations there, you know, retreat centers.
Synthesis is building one there, no?
I heard rumors.
I heard rumors.
So, you know, that's another way
you
to...
You can cut that out.
So, I have...
Please don't cut it out.
Okay. That's what I mean. But like the optimal future, right? Are we going to see temples everywhere? Or is it going to be digital platforms and you can go to somebody's... temple or house or even a hospital. What's the ideal future for psychedelic assisted therapy?
I don't want to really give my opinion on that too much. I believe that, you know, science and regulation will provide a framework eventually which will allow for the safest way for people to take psychedelics. In a medical, if not therapeutic way. What I hope is that with that, it will still be able for people to take psychedelics for their spiritual or recreative journey. Because I think it can help not only people that are sick, but also people that are searching or just coping with difficulties. And as we are moving towards... a medical application of psychedelics and regulation around that and patents around that, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It may well be, and I think it's a realistic future like image that psychedelics might be well spread for mentally ill people, but absolutely illegal for people that are not mentally ill.
So it's going to be a lot of people like trying to become mentally sick.
Right, exactly. So you remember, you know, in California, people getting the weed pass in order, I've got arthritis and whatever. Mm-hmm. And the doctors like inside streets, like giving people medical pass, whatever. Yeah, this mm-hmm. might be happening. But for me, what I really hope is that we recognize that this is a medicine, but it's not necessarily only medically supervised or like doctor supervised medicine, but other people can use it as well.
How do you think like informing people about the risks that come with psychedelics? Like even though if you go into like assisted therapy with like a guide who's really knowledgeable about psychedelics, there's always like the risk that you can have like a bad experience. Mm-hmm. And is this something you're trying to advocate with delics as well, or just mm-hmm. also like talking about the shadow sides of psychedelics more, and that they can have mm-hmm. many positive effects, but that is obviously mm-hmm. also always like a risk with taking psychedelics.
Mm-hmm. So first of all, with delics, we also want to develop screening procedures first for the guide seeker, mm-hmm. but also for the practitioner. So screening practitioners that we get on board.
Yeah.
But for the practitioners to screen seekers. So for example, if someone is manic,
mm.
or as we say nowadays, bipolar,
yeah.
that chances of psychedelics working in their favor are, you know, lower. And so we do not recommend them to take it.
Mm-hmm.
So there's obviously cases in which there's certain medicines involved or certain like medical history involved where it is not, you know, we don't advocate to take it. On the other hand, when it is supervised and guided, you were talking about a bad experience. How do you define a bad experience?
Like a short-lasting psychosis, or somebody's actually becoming more depressed from taking psychedelics, or you have a psychedelic, like a bad trip, and you're like, oh my God, it's like, I have to quit my job. It's like, mm-hmm. life is shit. And just like, mm-hmm. everything goes to ruin after. I don't mm-hmm. know.
Yeah, there's people getting fatalists, or, you know, like life has no meaning or purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for instance. Yeah.
I think we could work with that in the same way we do with other medicine that also have side effects, and antidepressants that have a long list of like very severe side effects, including people getting suicidal.
Yeah.
So I think we've been talking about the risks of psychedelics so much, mm-hmm. and I think that we can balance the skills a little bit and go like, okay, wait a second. It's not like regular medicine don't have side effects. Everything has side effects. So we need to work with that. But that doesn't mean that this is not something that we can use for good.
I think the future is bright.
Yeah, let's see.
In my opinion.
Yeah.
You're focusing on psilocybin, right? With your and do you have experience with psilocybin in the last years yourself? Is it a path you are walking as yourself for spiritual development?
So I mean, in the Netherlands, we would work with practitioners that work with truffles, but if we go to certain states in the US or to Canada, we would also have the possibility to work with other compounds. But having said that, yes, I do have quite an extensive experience with psilocybin and with some other psychedelics, and most recently with DMT in Changa form. And absolutely, I think these experiences have helped me cope with certain things in my life, and the way kind of my mentality in life, and being okay with not being in control. And yeah, absolutely. I like to compare it to the experience that I had at my meditation retreat. I did a Vipassana retreat, which I told you about in the beginning of this session, and there, through the means of not speaking for 10 days and meditating for 10 days, you go through, in my case, also horrible experiences, but eventually you have benefits that you can actually experience, but also neurological benefits. And to me, taking psychedelics in a responsible manner gives me very similar kind of effects and advantages. Yeah.
Great. Yeah, there's a lot of stigma, right, around also coming out as, for instance, researchers. You know, there's a bit of a stigma around researchers who take psychedelics themselves for some reason. And also for us, like doing a podcast about psychedelics, it can feel like, oh, we're doing something secretive, which is completely, you know, it's something you have to do. Like ram out of your system,
right?
kind of feel guilty sometimes. Like, my mom's gonna see this, and why would that matter? Like, you know, that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, like, how, you know, if you start such a platform, how do you deal with that yourself? Do you actually, you know, tell your family and friends and people in your LinkedIn, you know, like, okay, I'm involved with psychedelics, and is that still seen as something bad, or how do you say, you know, how you
No, absolutely. I am completely open about it. I am completely transparent about it. I think I need to be, because I also want to add to, you know, getting rid of the stigma around psychedelics. A lot of people still see people in the psychedelics industry as glorified drug dealers. And you know, that's their issue, and it's not mine. I believe in what I do, and I stand for what I do, and I don't really care if there's people that think differently. I will listen to them, and if they make a good argument, then I take it into consideration. But I'm not gonna let myself be sidetracked because people have an opinion. And when it comes to my family, this is actually interesting, because it was quite soon after I came up with this idea that I told my parents, and my father was very enthusiastic, and he's pretty old, so I didn't expect that to happen. My mom was a little bit more conservative in being enthusiastic, but you know, she accepts it, and I'd rather just tell them what I'm busy with and tell everyone what I'm busy with, because I want it to be normal to be engaged in this kind of stuff. So then there's my parents, and then there's, you know, further sides of the spectrum. On the age spectrum, there's my grandma, and there's my 17-year-old brother, almost 17, turned 17 this month. How do you tell them? And I have told them, and both of them don't really understand what it is I'm doing. And that's okay. But I'm not like being secretive about it. But like if they don't understand, then that's okay for now.
But it can be sometimes like just especially in casual conversations, you know, mm-hmm. just like meet somebody mm-hmm. at an event or like mm-hmm. at a birthday party. Mm-hmm. And I feel you have to like justify like what psychedelics can do, what kind of positive mm-hmm. impact they have on our mm-hmm. society or like what potential they have. You have to explain it very often. I mm-hmm. feel like at least, yeah, I experience this a lot as well. Like, what are you doing? I was like, so listen, psychedelics. Yeah. It's like, yeah. I got to tell you a thing or two about it.
Yeah.
I feel I've been talking about psychedelics a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Because you always have to kind of like start at the beginning mm-hmm. with some people who yeah. have no idea about psychedelics, like yeah. a friend, like a parent of a friend or, you know, like, mm-hmm. yeah, I feel you have to...
You have to
just justify yourself a lot for some people.
You have to analyze how well somebody knows psychedelics and yeah. then how much you're going to have to justify yeah. what you're doing.
Yeah.
Somebody doesn't know it at all and she's like a medical student, you know, which is a surprising thing, to be honest, like a medical yeah, student yeah, yeah. not knowing about, you know, yeah. DMT and PTSD yeah. or whatever, yeah. what DMT actually is.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, it's completely vital for yeah. human existence. But then they're like, I can see them looking at me with like, what are you talking about? And as if I'm saying something like conspiracy theory,
right?
And then I'm like in defense yeah. mode at a party yeah. and I'm trying to explain somebody and I actually want to get yeah. out of the conversation.
right. Interesting.
So yeah. if you put it on LinkedIn, there's all these people who are not understand, people who will mm-hmm. understand. Mm-hmm. For us, it's always like a little bit of a question, right?
Yeah.
How much
you... But I also see it as a challenge. Like I kind of like being in this because like it feels like doing... work for like the psychedelic mission we share, you know, like every time you have the opportunity to talk with someone who's like doesn't have any idea about psychedelics, yeah. sometimes it's like a bit again, but then it's always like a little opportunity you also have to like shine.
And it's also like, okay, if you're, you know, wearing a suit and a tie and you have a PhD in neuroscience, then it's okay, mm-hmm. right? Then it's all right to talk mm-hmm. about it. You go to all these conferences, you stick between the guidelines, you don't mm-hmm. fuck around, you know, mm-hmm. you do that privately,
mm-hmm.
right? You do that in the confines yeah. of your own home, then you're yeah. a big spacey hippie.
Yeah.
But out in the open, you are not, you know, adhering to all the rules and blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. There's no space for saying, you know, you just want to explore the universe and explore the confines of your own brain and your reality, and that's okay.
Right.
There's so yeah. much stigma, and
yeah.
especially in your scene too.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think usually when people ask me what I do, I first tell them that I'm setting up I frame it, right? So I tell them I'm setting up a platform that connects practitioners and patients in the mental health care space. Okay, interesting, but aren't there many platforms that are already doing that? And so, okay, well, yeah, but mine's kind of different because, and this is also always how I start, is say, scientific research is increasingly showing that X, Y, Z on psychedelics. And yeah. so what we are doing is bring that into practice. And then actually, most people tend to, maybe it's just because I'm really scary, I don't know. But like they accept and it's and they don't criticize me in the face, you know. But yeah, I don't know, like
that's a good elevator pitch too. we should work on that. We should have an elevator pitch for a party, and we should have an elevator pitch professionally.
Yeah,
exactly. We're not, we didn't prepare that one, but yeah, that's a good way to deal with it for sure. But it can be a tricky industry, so that's why I also like to talk about somebody else who's, you know, you're not a researcher, you're not an NGO, you're a business, right?
Yeah.
So psychedelic businesses, how does that operate, and do we still have to, you know, always be on our toes constantly and, you know, watch our words, or can mm-hmm. we be a little bit more liberal these days?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, a question about our project too.
Okay.
Because, you know, we're making the portal box for DMT, mm-hmm. But we're soon also going to work on the psilocybin box.
Mm-hmm.
And we're doing something completely different from you, but it's the same kind of space. And mm-hmm. half of our, actually, I think everyone that's interested in our box has seen significant growth with psychedelics, either by treating their depression or, usually, you know, it's depression treatment, right? It's people who are stuck in a certain situation, and the psychedelics have really shown them, like, okay, you can fix something, and it's related to a trauma in your past or whatever, and it's helped them tremendously. Also with the psilocybin box, the mushroom box that we're going to be building, some people use it for exploration, like, okay, what's more out there? And some people use it for healing. And usually it's a combination of both. What's important if people are using it at home, they don't want a practitioner, perhaps you do it with friends, a trip sitter.
Or if alone. You can give us...
What would you need in a box? You mean?
Yeah, is there anything that's vital for this box in their house, this sacred central place that defines their set and setting? What's an incredibly important component that should be in there?
Obviously, you don't recommend anyone to take any of these substances.
I feel like I'm in one of these crypto YouTube channels, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
I am not a financial advisor.
I'm not psychedelic advisors right here. We are just friends talking about psychedelics.
So let me ask you, is that going to be geared more towards microdosing or...
No, it's gonna not be geared towards microdosing, but people can use it for microdosing. It's going to be geared towards dosages that people feel right for themselves. And it's going to come with instructions and the right tools. And the right tools and the right instructions are based on the input we get from thousands of users and experts.
Okay. And do you discriminate between truffles and mushrooms? Or
they're not going to come in the box. So it's mostly usage, right?
Right.
Most likely it's going to be how to create your own set and setting with the ceremony, with cups. And,
Yeah.
But we're brainstorming, and that's why we like talking with people like you.
Yeah.
Who could, you know, then we gather input from all sorts of places.
What I would love in a box like that, because you have an amazing booklet with your box, and, you know, obviously people are going to ask for a scale, and people might ask for, like, different, like, appliances. What I would love in such a box is instructions on how to brew tea, how to make chocolate, how to... engage in lemon tech effectively in order to not have, you know, visceral issues that people tend to have on using truffles or psilocybin or mushrooms. So these kind of things would be highly beneficial for me.
Yeah. And that's preparation, and then for the usage you have tools, and then for integration, is there anything particular you also think that should be there? Because normally in your work you have the practitioners helping with the integration aspects as well, right? Long after.
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, actually one of the things we're working on is actually facilitating the integration within the platform as well. Obviously you want most of the integration to take place in person. But what you see with many practitioners is that integration is not much more than a 10-minute conversation after the trip, and then you go home and nothing happens. So if you are able to connect practitioner and guide seeker after that moment, you can improve integration. So is there anything I would like to see in the box that connects with integration other than what you're already doing with the DMT box, is what you're asking?
Yeah. Maybe we should have phone numbers, people.
What? Okay.
You want to discuss your trip with Sebastian over here?
He
always
wants
to listen to your
story. Like a little QR code you scan, and then there's just like
a video chat.
Hey.
In the box, there's an LCD screen, and then there's a live.
You know what? What would be really interesting and would be nice for you... there's a guy that I met. I won't mention his name here now, because given the industry that we're in, I'm not entirely sure if he's comfortable with being mentioned.
Here we go. Yeah, I completely understand.
Yeah. So yeah. Myself, I really don't mind mentioning me, because, you know, but like I would need to ask him first. But what he did is he made cards, playing cards, if you will, that are integration, that are geared towards integrating the psychedelic experience yourself. Okay. or actually are being used during your trip in order to reflect more or direct your trip or guide your trip in a certain direction.
Questions or something on there?
Yeah, exactly. That trigger you. Certain questions or certain suggestions, etc., etc. And something like that, like putting cards like that in the box, I think would be really cool. So
you can put them around your house, maybe.
A psychedelic card game.
Oh,
Psychedelic spiritual development card game.
Oh. Yeah. So he made it already. I will get you in touch. It's super great guy.
Right.
That's super interesting. Yeah.
Probably got also. I think he's also going to Insight in September. So if you guys are coming,
amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, man, that's awesome. I don't have any other ideas or suggestions for questions, or if you want to talk about anything else.
I didn't come here with any expectations. It's just great to talk to you guys, and Koen, great meeting you, and thanks for the opportunity to talk about Delix a little bit. Short shout out, if there's any developers or lawyers out there that like think this project is really, really cool, hit me up. We'll talk.
Where can they find you?
Delix.com.
Right.
Maybe let's put this in.
Okay. Click contact and see your pretty face, and then I'll just.
Who knows? Who knows? Who knows? And that's Delix with a Q, so DELIQS.com.
Yeah. We have that same issue, right? We have to like Portier and then P-O-R-T-I-E-R. Shit. All right. Thanks for listening, guys. Yeah. Check out Delix.com. And we'll see you next time.
Yes. Amazing.
Bye-bye.
Ciao-y.
Thank you.
Cool.
All right.
Awesome.
Amazing. Thanks, man.
Thank you. That was fun.